What's happening, my fellow ghouls and ghoulettes? Welcome to a brand new episode of Cosplay Chris. And today we are talking about five things you probably didn't know about Freddy Krueger's infamous razor glove from the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise. I have been looking forward to doing this video for a very long time because this is very near and dear to me, ghouls and ghoulettes. As some of you may know, I got my start in building props and building things in general by making Freddy Krueger gloves when I was, I think, 12 or 13 years old. So much so, I bought a little memento along to show you guys. Alrighty, so this is a very special memento, ghouls and ghoulettes. Before I get to this piece here, what you see here are some original blades from my very first full metal glove that I built when I was about 12 or 13 years old. So here's a photo of the glove, and here's a photo of little fat me wearing the glove next to my Freddy Krueger cardboard cutout. These blades were made from a baked beans can, and the rest of the armature was made from a Diet Coke can. So the blades did fall off due to my fine craftsmanship and never using a soldering iron before. They're very flexible, so they're stunt blades. Now, moving on, this is one of the first full kind of, you know, metal gloves that I built when I was a lot more confident. I built this back in 2003/2004. So it's a part six up here and then a versus back plate here. And this back plate was actually signed by Robert Englund. So it's a goofy looking glove, very, very small, but I found it and I didn't have the heart to throw it away because it's, you know, it's my humble beginnings. It's where I came from. So I keep this thing in a racing car model display case. Now, what I also wanted to show you guys is my original book of templates, measurements, and receipts from my glove building days. So I kept everything in here. Now, this piece in particular is very special because I took this to LA in 2010 to Weekend of Horrors, and I showed this to Robert Englund. Robert personally went through this with me, sat down with a glass of wine, and just went through all the gloves that I'd built. And I purposefully built all these gloves, took photos right before I went away to show him. And he had wonderful things to say about it. He told me great stories about all the gloves on set and stuff like that. And when he first wore the glove, we've got a receipt for copper, a giant $342 sheet of copper I bought in 2010. Here's a scan of one of the original knives that I will get to in the video. One of the Part 5 Hero gloves. There's the pipe scrape scene glove. There is a Travis Kalsil Krueger glove there that was great reference for weathering. Now here is a blade template that I had drawn up by a laser cutter here in Sydney. So that was pretty cool. And I just wanted to keep that. Now here, this is funny. These are not rejected, but retired templates that I used cereal boxes to draw on. So these are all retired templates. Nice little trip down memory lane. Now, if you're also wondering why I've got some leather gloves here, well, they'll come into play a little bit later. Now, before we get started, I just want to give a massive shout out to my amazing crew over at the Freddy Glove Ninja Clan on Facebook. I've been a member since 2011, and they literally are like a family to me. They have helped me along the way with my glove building journey. I've been fortunate enough to have Robert Englund wear one of my gloves at a convention for photo ops. Had a sit down with him, as I mentioned before, whilst going through my portfolio of gloves back in 2010. So I figured this would be a fun video, not just for glove experts, but for people that are relatively new and just know the look of Freddy's glove, but don't know the true history of his glove. So tip your fedoras and settle in, because we're gonna be talking about five things you didn't know about Freddy's glove. Number five, how Wes Craven came up with the concept of the glove. So during Wes Craven's creation of Freddy Krueger, which I think is a wonderful story, an amazing movie trivia to tell, especially around people that aren't familiar with the character, they just know the name. We know that Craven chose red and green on Freddy's sweater because it is the hardest two colors for the human eye to process side by side. Freddy was based on an old man that scared the absolute shit out of Wes when he was a kid walking by. He must have been an old drunk. He had a hat like Freddy. The burn makeup was a result of Craven wanting his character to have a personality and not just a mute wearing a mask. So he figured a mask of scar tissue, that way he's still able to emote. Now, when it came to the glove, much like the makeup where he wanted something different when it came to the villain's weapon. At an age where it was machetes, butcher's knives, chainsaws, Craven thought, what is going to stand out from a crowd? He then thought back to primitive days, cavemen. What were they escaping from? Saber-toothed tigers or a
tiger would put their claw around the side of a cave trying to go after their prey. He had that notion of using the hand anatomy. Building upon that, we got the infamous glove. And what finally sealed the deal when he was in a writer's block in terms of designing this character, he just took one look at his cat who was kneading and he's like, ah, yeah. That's the one. Number four, numerous gloves were used throughout all of the films. Now, at first glance for novices of the Elm Street series and Freddy Krueger in general, you just think they use the same glove throughout the entire series. And I used to be like that when I was a wee lad, but that is not the case. However, that is the case for the first and second Nightmare on Elm Street, much in the vein of the Halloween Michael Myers mask that was used in the first Halloween in 1978 and the second Halloween in 1981, the first glove was then carried over to Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2, Freddy's Revenge. But by then, the glove had seen some cosmetic changes, some wear and tear. The blades had been dulled, sharpened, and just were beat to hell. The color had changed quite a bit on the metal armature, the copper piping, as well as the brass backplate. And by the end of it, the ringlets had come off and there was wire holding the glove together, as you can see right here from some promotional photos of Robert sporting the glove for Part 2. Now, that glove was then used to create the hero glove slash gloves for Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3, along with the stunt gloves. A completely different glove was then built for Nightmare on Elm Street Part 4, along with several other metal gloves that included the apple cutting scene glove, as well as the dojo glove when we see Rick meet his demise at the hand of Sensei Kruger. Part 5, The Dream Child, I've lost count with how many metal gloves were built for that one. Ryan Effner built the gloves for parts 5 and 6. He was a smoke technician on Nightmare 4, but then got promoted to building the gloves for part 5 and 6, and there have just been an array of part 5 gloves out there that have surfaced and gone to auction. I have lost count. I know one of my glove brethren will comment down below and give me the exact number, because there are a lot. Then of course there was the Hero Part 6 glove that actually went through some changes halfway through production. You can tell the fingertips were swapped out and other parts changed here and there on the glove. We then obviously have that beautiful organic bone claw from Wes Craven's You Nightmare. And then of course there was the Freddy vs. Jason gloves slash gloves. There were a few Hero gloves, a Part A, a Part B, as well as the stunt gloves. And then we have the bulky and brutish remake glove from the 2010 film. Number three, tomato knives were used on the original glove. Now, when the shorter documentary Never Sleep Again, The Making of a Nightmare on Elm Street came out years ago, they were interviewing Jim Doyle, who designed the glove. He did these blueprints right there, and then the hero glove was subsequently built by Lou Carlucci and Charlie Blodnelli.
Here's a little bit of bonus trivia for you guys. The hands that are building Freddy's glove at the beginning of the film are that of Charlie Blodnelli's, the co-builder of the original Freddy glove. It must have been one of those things where Robert Englund was unavailable, and from what I understand, they shot this sequence at the end of production. So it must have just been a quick scramble and they needed someone's hands, and they grabbed Charlie and threw him in the Freddy sweater and got him to build the glove.
But obviously Jim helped source the pieces for the glove, and that included pre-existing tomato knives. Now, the exact brand of these bad boys is the Case XX P210 tomato knife. And I've been fortunate enough to own one of these bad boys, and it cost me a cool $150 US just for one. I've seen people that have gathered four of these and had them put on their high-end Freddy gloves, their part 1 slash part 2 gloves, and man, they are beautiful. They are something to behold, and there's something so different about having the exact same make and model knife on your glove. So obviously Jim, Charlie, and Lou took the handle off, tipped it upside down, cut in and ground in the groove, and then brazed them onto the copper pipe fingertips. Again, if you can find these on eBay, they're an absolute rarity, much like the Graflexes for lightsabers from Star Wars. It's ridiculous. These are the ruby slippers of sourcing same make and model prop pieces. Number two, the original glove resurfaced after 25 years. So like I mentioned, the original glove was used in production of the 1984 Nightmare on Elm Street. It was then carried over to the 1985 Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge, where it had seen some better days, bit of wear and tear. Again, much like the Halloween mask in parts 1 and 2, it was a lot dirtier, a lot shabbier, and a lot more beat up. Oh shit. Now, the glove was then handed off to Scott Nesselrode, who built the gloves for Nightmare on Elm Street 3. So he was using this as reference to build the hero glove for part 3, Dream Warriors. For some reason, Scott spray painted the hero glove brown. I guess just to see what it would look like with a brown hue, because ultimately the hero part 3 glove does have brown spray paint on it and black spray paint. You can see all the speckles all over the metal armature. Then all of a sudden, the glove was just misplaced and just disappeared and vanished into obscurity. Cut to 25 years later, where Elm Street prop collector Mike Becker saw the hero glove minus the leather glove up on an auction site that was labeled as a prototype glove for Nightmare on Elm Street Part 5, and in his own words, he knew that was complete bullshit. By that time, the glove had already sold, so Mike contacted the auction house, submitted an offer. The owner of the glove then accepted that offer, sent the glove back, and Mike got the Hero Glove. After 25 years, the glove had resurfaced. And as a glove builder, I can't tell you how pivotal that was for our community. I'm geeking out hard right now, ghouls and ghoulettes, and glove builders can back me up on that one. It was a magical day when those photos surfaced and we saw the Hero Glove in all its glory. Granted, it had seen better days, but it was a beautiful sight to behold, just to see that thing up close in HD. And see like the details, the real details, as opposed to seeing a VHS, DVD, or a Blu-ray of the original and second Elm Street, and seeing these HD shots, it was fucking magical. The glove now resides in a museum, which is great, along with one of the hero sweaters from part one. So it's a happy ending for that one. And it's cool to see things come full circle when it comes to movie props. Number one, what materials the gloves are made from. So let's start off with the original glove used in A Nightmare on Elm Street 1 and A Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2. For the finger armatures, we have Type M copper pipe. We then have a brass back plate. And of course, the knives are the P210 Case XX tomato knives. After that, the gloves were built from sheet copper for the finger armatures, as far as we know, and they continued the brass back plate and copper finger stalls combination, along with either scratch built knives or pre-existing knives. Now, when it came to the Wes Craven's new Nightmare glove, I'm pretty sure that was silicon, a silicon glove, and then with resin pieces, and then with actual machined blades on it that would probably be swapped out. When you have the stunt glove, you'd have your rubber blades and stuff like that. The remake glove was all copper from what I remember, and they actually milled out these copper caps for the fingertips with these massive chunky blades that were either MIG welded or TIG welded. Ask Jameson Knapp from Dark Dream Design, he'll tell you if it was MIG or TIG. He's told me before, but I always get the two confused, whether it's MIG or TIG, because they rhyme. Now, going back to why I have these leather gloves here. So these are original vintage Wells Lamont gloves. And the reason why I have two left gloves minus the red ball and tape, because obviously I used the right-handed ones for gloves and had to utilize the ball and tape, but I kept these as mementos and keepsakes because these things are probably nearly as old as me. Now, these are the same make and model leather gloves they use for the parts 4, 5, and 6. Now, if we look at the blueprint of the original glove from the first Nightmare on Elm Street that Jim Doyle drew up, he points to the leather glove that he's drawn and labels it as a Wells Lamont 900. It's quite an interesting leather, and I swear I have encountered one of those leathers before and bought a couple of them off eBay. These were vintage. They smelt like grandpa. But yeah, just cool to show you guys that these are the same make and model leather gloves that they use for the parts 4, 5, and 6. This one has the Trucker's Special stamp on it. So funny enough, at the end of Jason Goes to Hell, The Final Friday, when Freddy's glove comes out of the ground and takes Jason's hockey mask down to hell, they use the Trucker's Special because they covered up the Trucker's Special logo with some black. It's like a black diamond on the leather glove. It's a really weird design, but they use the Trucker's Special. Now, I will say that we're done with this list, but I'm gonna give you a little bonus round. The original glove wasn't even finished during production of the first Nightmare on Elm Street. So that awesome scene in the first Nightmare on Elm Street where Nancy sees Tina in the body bag and follows her down to the boiler room where she encounters Mr. Krueger, who then slices his torso open to reveal some lovely looking maggots under there. At that stage of filming, the glove wasn't even finished. And if you have a look right here, when Freddy has his hand raised, you can see rubber bands holding the armature onto the leather glove as opposed to its brass ringlets. And this shot here where Freddy is about to scrape his blades on the pipe in front of Nancy, you can see bits of the rubber band that are holding the armature on. Time is of the essence with these films back in the day, ghouls and ghoulettes, and they needed it on set as soon as possible. They obviously needed the hero glove, the close-up glove, as opposed to the stunt glove. The stunt glove may have not even been built at that point. Either way, little bonus bit of trivia for you guys. So guys, thank you so much for watching, and thank you for putting up with me geeking the fuck out over some Freddy glove goodness. Again, I hold this topic near and dear to my heart. It's my original bread and butter in prop making, and I wouldn't be where I am without it, nor the amazing Mr. Krueger himself. So guys, drop a comment below and let me know your thoughts on your favorite look of Freddy's infamous glove. And with that being said, ghouls and ghoulettes, wherever you are in the world, have yourselves an absolute cracker of a day. Hope you're well, hope you're happy, be merry, be silly. And until next time, ghouls and ghoulettes, please always remember, cosplayers do it best.
Looks better on you, bucko.